Welcome to Fuzzy Logic episode 30, everybody. Thank you for joining in. Without any further ado, I'm going to jump right into the introduction. So I am Nausheen and I work with the networks team at Seoul. And the speaker for today, like you know, is Anandi, who's currently working as a product manager at Vajro. She's an experienced product manager and she has a demonstrated history of working in SaaS products and information technology as well. She has more than 7 years of experience and hence she has a lot of expertise in multiple areas like A/B testing, market research, pricing, and a lot more, like much, much more. And so today she's going to be talking about pricing and value-based pricing. What are the factors that, how simple change in your pricing can generate revenue and multiple things. So yeah, over to you, Anandi. We're really excited to hear you.
Thank you for the nice introduction. And thank you guys for joining on a Friday evening. Means a lot of effort. So as she introduced, let me quickly introduce, I'm Anandi, and feel free to question, and you have any doubts, feel free. I'll try my best to resolve it as well. And hopefully you find the session useful for Friday. I'll start sharing my screen and we can jump on to the presentation as well. Okay, so welcome to the session. Again, thank you for joining on a Friday evening. And it's really nice to have you all, to meet you all in a virtual setting. I think the entire world is in a virtual setting, so it's not new to any of us doing Zoom calls as well. So this session primarily is my learnings on pricing. And I had this wonderful opportunity to work on pricing for Freshdesk. So a quick introduction, I started as a business analyst and slowly moved into product analytics. And from there, my journey into product management. And this was one of the key assignments that I am proud of. And a lot of learning was there. And price is something that we probably think, okay, it's a very, very small thing. And many companies actually don't give a lot of importance to it. But there are a lot of other psychological factors involved, beyond the economics and the business aspects as well. So I'll go through the session directly and let's start with a quick example. So just take a moment and decide which one you would choose. So you see this menu, you have this burger of 30 rupees. And for 85, you have a burger, you have a Coke and you have a French fries. So just keep in your mind. So I'm not able to take a survey here, but I'm sure you'll be able to connect with the points. So there are only two choices. So I'm assuming that it is a lot easier to decide which among the two you would choose. So it's totally based on personal preference, right? So I like burger and then I just go with a burger. I don't need a Coke. I don't need a French fries. I just go for option A, right? So it's totally based on personal preference. Now, see the menu right now. Okay, leave aside this and see the menu right now. You get a single burger for 30 rupees. You have a burger and a Coke for 80. And you have a combo of burger, Coke and French fries for 85. So for 5 rupees extra, probably you're getting a French fries, which is inflation beaten for sure, right? So now, what was your option? So if you had chosen A before, a lot of you would have actually chosen C now. C meaning 85 rupees, the combo, right? I'm sure mentally you're able to frame things. If you were already in B, you will surely go for C because for 5 rupees extra, you're getting French fries. It's a no-brainer. And a lot more of these people who chose A, that is only burger, would have actually felt, for 80, it's burger plus Pepsi. I might actually not need French fries and Pepsi at the moment, but I'll still go for 85. There are still a few categories where people actually stay on burger. They still choose 30, but the segment becomes smaller. So the business as such, would gain a lot more revenue, only primarily because a lot more people are now choosing 85 over 30. So 30 is still going to exist, but it's going to be much lesser than the previous menu where you just had two options. So pricing can make a lot of difference in small, leave aside SaaS or a big business, but right from a restaurant chain to how the combos are designed and your buffet meal is designed, every price is meant to psychologically affect your brain and indeed choose an option that would be more profitable for the business. Okay, don't get scared, no? Yeah. Okay, so I hope you guys understand why pricing is so important. I'll move into, you know, quickly a rough framework that I used for when I worked on this pricing statement. So the problem statement was primarily to, you know, look at the pricing of, I worked for a flagship product called Freshdesk then, and understand and come up with a pricing framework. So I had no idea about what framework to go about and nothing about willingness to pay, no metrics, no understanding, nothing at all. So I did research and I went step by step. So first was understanding these three concepts. One is cost-based pricing, competitor-based pricing, and value-based pricing. So I'll explain one by one. First is cost-based pricing. So assume that I'm a business owner, okay? So I probably manufacture or produce biscuits. Like, let's take a simple example for us to understand. So the cost to produce the biscuit packet might be 5 rupees, okay? So as a business owner, I don't know how to price. Quickly, what I would do, okay, cost to business is actually 5 rupees. I need a margin of 20%. I'm actually happy with 20%. So I'll quickly do like 20% of 5 and I'll sell it at 6 rupees or 7 rupees, depending on what margin I want, right? That is cost-based pricing, where you decide the margin and based on whatever cost has been incurred to you to, you know, produce the product or service whatsoever. So in SaaS, it would be the developer cost, your server cost, and other things put together. So that's the cost to the product. So you set up a margin. It can be X percentage, 20%, 30%. So that is cost-based pricing. So that will, of course, lead to certain level of profit. We'll move on to the next one. That's called competitor-based pricing, where, okay, like I'm into this cream biscuit segment, dude. Let me look at other cream biscuits. How are they priced, you know? So they are priced at 12. Oh, okay. So I initially thought of 6 or 7 would give me my profit margin. But actually, you know, cream biscuit seems to be the flavor. And let me just sell it for 12 or even 10, you know, because the competitor is selling at 12. Let me reduce and sell it at 10. I'll still get a good margin, right? So that is completely competitor-based pricing, where I see competitors' features or product and I'll reduce my price slightly so that, you know, I'm more attractive in terms of pricing. Okay, so that's competitor-based pricing. And third being value-based pricing. So I've already given a keynote, prefer value-based pricing. So yeah, so value-based pricing is when you take the competitor's input, but also you understand what value you provide to your consumer. So suppose the cream biscuit is a lot more tastier, is a lot more crunchier. You have better cream biscuits than your competitor. Then pricing at 10, you might be losing those revenue factors. So you have to see competitor and plug in what extra you will be providing. That is value-based pricing. So based on your product's value is how you're going to derive this. So these are the three, you know, pricing structures. We'll quickly see through like how generally it works out to be. This is in terms of dollars. So assume it's in rupees, it's completely fine. So as I mentioned before, the first one, my cost is in red. Like it costs about $50. I'm pricing in between like around $60. I still get around $10 profit. You know, that's cost-based pricing where I set up margin. Competitor is then your price becomes slightly, you know, higher or lower depending on your competitors, and profit actually reduces further because you're seeing your competitor and you have to reduce it from there. You never know how he has priced, right? So obviously the margin reduction will be there. The third being value-based pricing, where you plug in your value, the value that you give to consumer, and derive the profits. So these are the three models. And of course, if you're a SaaS, let me go into SaaS from biscuit. Okay. So if you're a SaaS-based company where you've just started, everybody goes for a competitor-based pricing. And it makes a lot of sense because you want to gather a good market share, right? Only when you are priced lesser than your competitor, you are going to get eyeballs to your website. So competitor-based pricing can be a good start for any SaaS-based business. And as you progress, as you get more market share, you should start looking into this value-based pricing. So obviously, these are the three concepts. So any questions, maybe towards the end, we can gather up. So I hope this concept was clear. The second thing that I did was a quick persona, you know, understand my customer persona. So when I went to Freshdesk, there are already quite a few customers. So I had a good chunk of customers from whom I can derive a lot of attributes, like, you know, demographic attribute, like, okay, these business look forward to Freshdesk, for example, right? There are many attributes, demographic attributes, and what features they value in your product. That can be one important attribute that you can look upon. So leave aside all the metrics below, which I'll go in the next slide. So just see till least value feature. So you need to, you know, have persona saying, you know, ABC person, and he's my consumer, he or she. And these are the features that they found valuable. Again, this comes from customer research, which you can do in multiple ways in terms of setting up a survey to your existing customers, or you can also telephone and quickly, you know, understand what is happening, or a Zoom call, whatever works, right? So understand what features they actually use in your product currently that are your valuable feature, which are the least valued feature, like they don't use actually. Okay. So that's going to give a lot of information to you. And the third factor is going to be the willingness to pay. Now, this willingness to pay, how do you derive this metric, or how do you understand? Okay. Now, if I go and ask a consumer, how much would you like to, you know, pay for a cream biscuit? He would say, okay, I just want to pay 1 rupee. Now, that's not practically possible, right? So any consumer would price your product super less. So that's not going to be the question that you want to ask your consumer to derive this WTP, which stands for willingness to pay. So how do you derive this? So there are a four set of questions that you can ask, okay? So at what price would you consider the product to be expensive that you will not buy? So this question will get the consumer thinking, and you will get a lot of good responses. Dude, like, anything beyond $500, I'm not going to pay. A lot of these metrics are in dollars, primarily because Freshdesk market is in the US. But tweak it according to your currencies. There are no issues. So at what price point does my product become too expensive for you? Like, you will not buy. Any cream biscuit beyond 100 rupees, I'm surely not going to buy. So the too expensive value would be 100 rupees in that case, right? And the second question you will have to question is, at what price you would price in such a way that the quality wouldn't be very good. Like, you think, oh, it's just, okay, imagine a cream biscuit selling for 50 paise. Okay, it's not there though. Okay, assume. So you would be like, oh, I'm not going to buy that, right? It's, I don't think the quality is going to be good. You've not even tasted it, but you're going to assume certain factors based on the pricing points, right? So that is the price where it's too cheap that, you know, your consumer are not going to give you a try. So that's the second question that's going to help you. And the third is where you would be expensive, but you'll still be okay to buy. So, you know, 100 rupees cream biscuit, no, too expensive. Whereas still 40 or 50, I'm okay to stretch, right? So that would be the value that you would plug in there. And the fourth question is, at what price would you consider the product to be a bargain or a great buy for money? Like, you know, as a consumer, this is a metric that you need to be super careful of, because they're going to tell your product in a very low light. So this is the last one alone. You need to be a little careful while taking the inputs. But it's good to always have inputs and quickly measure up. Okay, so these four points put together is going to give you a quick graph. Okay, so I've just marked it across consumers. This is just a sample graph where, you know, you have this too cheap, too expensive, it's cheap, good value, you know, the ranges of graph based on your consumer, you're going to quickly plot it. And your price range typically should be between too cheap to too expensive. So obviously your upper limit is going to be too expensive. You don't want to reach 100 rupees for a cream biscuit, but you can actually price it surely less than 100 rupees. And too cheap is something like a 5 rupees or a 6 rupees or something like that. So that is your price band that you can look forward to. And in case of products like biscuit, you have just one price. So it's slightly complicated, but in SaaS, you have multiple packages, right? So you have multiple plans. So your price range of your plan can be like in between this $200 to like $600. I can have like 4 plans or 5 plans or 3 plans, right? So this gives you the range in which you can probably start estimating your price. So the first few points, again, think of like cost based, or you're going to go competitor based or value. It depends on your business. Then you understand who are your current consumers, like our customers. Understand that persona in terms of demographic data, their willingness to pay, which is a very, very important metric. Again, plot these things and understand the price range that you want to occupy in. Now we've got a good price range, right? Okay, $200 to $600. Now you can have 3 plans, 5 plans, and there are multiple aspects to it, whether to price it at $200 or $199, which will sell better and things like that, right? So I'll quickly move on to the next few strategies that are, you know, quick growth hacks. They are like growth hacks for pricing that will help you understand in this band, how do I effectively increase my pricing and revenue, most importantly. So I think we already saw an example that was like a decoy, the 80 rupees, the one combo. Mm-hmm. So the major, you know, strategy or a growth hack that's going to help you in pricing is going to be your decoy pricing. So I'll explain in case you don't know what a decoy pricing is. It's a super important thing that can quickly drive up your revenue. So assume again, you have, you know, just two options, and 89 and 149, you know, it's all dollars, but yeah, you can assume in your currency of rupees. So you have two mixies, like this is a 900 watt with a 5-piece mixie or whatsoever. Mm-hmm. This is 1200 with 12-piece set. Okay, it has a lot more features, but it is like at 149, right? So again, you will choose, then there are always two options you're going to choose based on what you require and what you can pay, right? What you can afford. So the choice is relatively simpler in two. But imagine a case where you have three options now. You have a quick $125, okay? Now this is like, 1000 watts, and it has also a 9-piece set. So imagine, guys, like on this bucket of, you know, having the first one, the $89, they would rethink, okay, like a few dollars more or a few rupees more, I can get better features. Even if I'm not able to afford 149, I can still go for this. Or many of them would also think otherwise, like, okay, the difference is just 24. Okay, let me quickly, you know, look at this, because this seems to be the most valuable option, right? So here, this $125 acts as a decoy plan, okay, or a decoy pricing with all the features. This is mainly to sell the highest plan. So you want to sell the 149 more, right? If you just have a 89 on and 149, you're letting your consumers choose based on their preference. But when you have this, you know, extra option, that's going to create a little bit of confusion. Okay, should I see more on value? Okay, let me actually try 125. Then they'll slowly move on. Oh, just $24 more. Let me go to this. So that's the general, you know, thinking of any consumer. And I'm sure that's how we've done in many cases. Like I can show you umpteen number of examples, like right from Apple phones to your Netflix. I have screenshots. Yeah. So you never realize that's what you've been tricked to do. But yeah, unfortunately, yeah, that's how businesses work. Yeah. They work for revenue. So this entire thing is called as decoy pricing, where you attract the consumer with the highest priced item. So I'll say like, oh, okay, 149 seems to be better option. 125, just $24 jump. It's actually fine, dude. You know, that's how you'll start thinking. So you go with a better alternative, and it's going to help the business gain more revenue. Not a lot of people will actually look into the $89 right now. So this decoy pricing, there are umpteen number of examples, like Apple Watch, okay? They've done a reverse of what I told previously. So they first introduced this $399 Apple Watch and $699. Predominantly, their revenue came from $399, which obviously as a business, you don't want, right? Mm-hmm. So they quickly introduced this where it was like super expensive, like $12,000, right? Now, $12,000 is super huge. Unlike the previous example where the pricing was pretty close, where, okay, I can jump here, I can jump there. Here it's pretty steep. So when I see these three options, if I would have seen just the two, maybe few here, few there, a lot of people were here according to the study though. And quickly on introducing this 12,000, people would feel like, oh, many wouldn't be able to afford. It's super expensive for an Apple Watch, right? And they would, you know, quickly move to $699. They wouldn't even consider this $399 as an option, primarily because okay, let me compromise because I'm not able to afford this, but let me at least go for the next best alternative. Okay, so having just two, actually you would have probably chosen $399, but having three with super high priced is going to compromise you, and they're going to move you to the middle bucket, right? So this study where predominantly users were like about 80% of users were choosing $399, and then the split was more towards here, where this became like more than 3/4 quarter, like 75% or something like that, after introducing this option. So they know this is not going to sell, right? They know this 12,000, not many people can afford. There is a segment, of course, but not that much, right? So still they would introduce, this is again, this 12,000 is a decoy pricing. Decoy pricing meaning, I don't mind if it doesn't sell, but the main aim is to sell the next best or the compromise effort. So this is called as compromise. So there are two decoy pricing. One is the attractive effect where you make them sell the highly, you know, you choose, let your consumers choose the highly priced one. Whereas in this compromise, you're like, okay, let me compromise and buy the median value good. So decoy pricing is super helpful for businesses, not for consumers. And quick example, Starbucks coffee, take anything around you, you will find this decoy pricing. And once you make a note mentally in your mind, you'll be able to quickly spot those as well, right? Five and six, okay, I don't need $6, dude. Why do I spend an extra dollar here? There's a $9, then you'll be like, oh, let me just go for $6. Like, not a lot would go for five, you know. It's a quick decision. And iPhones, Apple, you know, they always do this where, you know, they have this previous model in a price range of 900, and this iPhone 7 was, you know, ordered in 1054. Now when you see this, you would be like, oh, let me just go for 7 plus 2, like it's just $20 difference, right? So they're making you buy the highly priced product only because having this as a decoy, like 900 previous model, no, I don't want to buy. Let me go for this. The price difference is pretty less. This is a screenshot of Netflix. I'm sure all of us have this, where many of us would probably have gone for standard, right? $649. Ultra HD in Netflix is cool, but not many people would have the eye for such a detail. And many of you would have actually stuck on to standard if just three plans were available. But this has just one feature extra, and you just see this like it's just 100 rupees. Okay, like I don't even know what a Ultra HD is, but I would still go for 799 thinking that it's the best. Only because it's priced together and standard is a decoy here.
You know what? Actually, that's my package that I use.
All of us use that. So anywhere you see like, you know, Apple, Netflix, You would have probably not even, many people have an eye for Ultra HD, then it makes a lot more sense. I'm sure 75% at least don't have, right? At least the majority. So that's where, you know, it doesn't make a lot of difference, but you'll be like, okay, 100 rupees more, let me just pay for that one feature. You don't realize it's just the one feature that is available, right? So anywhere across, like you see this decoy pricing across, so this is one strategy that every SaaS business as well does. So if you see the average number of plans, if you would notice, two plans is never good because people would always choose there's a lot of traction towards the cheaper version of the plan. So generally, odd number of plans is preferred primarily to create confusion in consumers' mind so that it is a lot easier. So anything 3+ is a very, very good strategy for business so that consumers, you know, decide what package and finally they end up going to a highly paid or the highest plan version. So this is a quick recap of decoy plan. Again, we saw the example where we want a price range of 200 to 400. So two plans, you know, it's not going to work. So you need at least three plans to, you know, push consumers across the bucket so that your revenue is good. Moving on, I'm sure a lot of us would have seen this across, right? Right from, you know, small stores, leave aside SaaS, small stores to Kirana stores, many people have this 9 pricing, right? Groceries, anywhere you go. 99 rupees, even dresses, kurtas, many things that we buy, like everything would be $3.99, $6.99. So why actually does it help the business? Why is that so? I'm sure many of us do realize that $700 and $6.99 is probably a rupee and it actually doesn't make a lot of difference in our life. But it does have a lot of effect. Like iPhones always use, you know, all their prices more or less ends in 9, if you notice. It's primarily because the effect that 9 brings in, okay? So I'll quickly run through an example. So I have like a simple biscuit packet, like 9 rupees and 10 rupees. A lot of us, in spite of the difference being primarily just 1, mathematically and economically doesn't make a lot of difference, but lot of us would, you know, automatically go to 9 rupees, right? It's just so easy to decide, whereas, you know, probably this is not. Let's move to another example where digits are more. Again, you'll see the same effect, right? Let me take another example where it's 109 and 110, right? Here, if you notice, 109 is actually not great. And 110 is better for business. So everything is from business perspective and not from customer or consumer perspective. Only because you'll get 1 rupee more and 109 is not going to increase your conversion percentage. So why is that so? It's primarily because your left digit matters. So we have this tendency to read the prices from left to right. So you'd see the 9, you would see here 1. So there's a difference, right? Again, 9 and 1, you see a difference. So you feel this is, you know, lesser or shorter, lesser digits, fewer digits whatsoever. And again, 109 and 110, again, it all seems same because you read from left to right, more or less. 109 and 110, there's not much difference in conversion percentage at all. So it makes more difference when your left digit changes with a 9 in the end. It is always very good for conversions. So it's not just having a 9 towards your end, but make sure your left digit also changes. That's the most important psychological concept that why 9 pricing works. Let me move on to the next quick strategy where pennies a day strategy. I'm sure the name calls it all for what strategy it is, where, you know, a club membership or a gym membership. Okay. 3,000 rupees per month. Okay. This is just an example. I'm sure it's a lot expensive. 3,000 rupees per month. Okay, cool. Let me think about it. Okay. So, whereas if the business puts it this way, where, you know, it's just 100 rupees per day for gym membership, dude, for your health and all, with all the positioning statements meant, right? Just 1 rupee, just 14 rupees per day for, I'm sure this pennies a day you would have seen in insurance companies, right? They say just 13 rupees per day, you can cover up to 1 crore. You know, they never say the month. So for business, it really doesn't matter. It's the same month or day. It's exactly the same revenue they're going to get. But this automatically in consumers' mind, psychologically makes a lot of difference because they would calculate it day-wise. Okay, it makes sense. When you see day-wise, a lot of things make sense. Like something like a subscription makes a lot of sense and with good positioning and marketing can really capture a lot of audience. So this is primarily reframing your price based on your business again. And this really works for any subscription business like monthly, quarterly, and things like that. And with good marketing positioning can really drive up your revenue with just simple day pricing and not reducing your price. Okay, so I did speak about the marketing aspects. So pricing aspects, we have a few strategies. We can decide, okay, $199. We did have an example where our price band was between $200 and $600. Okay, let us have three plans, probably a quick run through. Okay, let me have $299, $399, and a $599, probably, and with different set of features in each plan. Now, marketing plays a super important role apart from getting your pricing right, right? It's very important that your marketing also plays its own part in, you know, establishing the pricing well. So let's a quick tip on how to price generally. There are a few things that have worked, and this is primarily based on research, where generally when your price ends in 9, that means your product is kind of, you have price ending in 9. Only for cheap products, not in terms of quality, in terms of price, right? So for example, cars never sell at, they never end at 9, right? They are like 7.2 lakhs or 11.2 lakhs. It's all a specific number, right? The price is a specific number. So generally this 9 ending thing comes only when your dollar value or your rupee value is pretty less, okay? And for more expensive goods, they prefer the exact pricing, and that's what sells as well, because 9 kind of lingers in our mind, oh, maybe it's a little cheap product, you know, that kind of thing comes along with 9. So you can't go for expensive products there. So when you go for something like 2999, this is a quick example of how your positioning and marketing should be. You should always go for gain frame messaging, primarily because you have already priced your product less, meaning that, okay, it's the cheapness is always there when the 9 comes. Okay, so go for something like, let's take the gym membership, for example. Let's assume he's going for 2999 instead of 3K. Okay, so the messaging should be gain frame. Gain frame meaning you don't have any negative words. You don't have like, don't miss, don't leave this opportunity out to get this offer. And those kind of messaging don't work with the 9 pricing. So if your price ends in 9, make sure that you have gain frame. So you can have a message like, get your 6-pack from us. You know, it's a lot more positive and something not negative, no negative words at all. Whereas if you price at 3K, you can do this, don't miss on getting a, you know, 6-pack from us, and you can go for loss frame. So this is primarily again based on research that has worked, you know, for many companies across, especially the Silicon Valley. So let me move on in terms of pricing. Again, marketing, the representation, a lot of things come hand in hand. So here, if you see, many of us have this habit of, you know, introducing commas, especially us, 1 lakh whatsoever. So make sure that you remove commas, nothing in commas for SaaS based pricing for sure, because it never works, because it becomes difficult to read, primarily because of that. The lesser syllables you have when you read when you mentally read a price should be lesser, your syllables should be lesser, right? So here it's obviously more because you're taking time to read, oh, is it 1,000 or 10,000 or what? So it's a lot easier here. So make sure you remove commas, no commas in SaaS-based pricing completely. Again, displaying prices in a small font that gives a perspective. Why is that important? Primarily, this is again for SaaS-based slash prices that are very, very small, meaning not the expensive goods, okay, not like automobiles or something like that. So here, why is this important? The font size equates your mind with the price. So lower the font size, automatically you'll be like, okay, maybe it's cheaper, it's fine, you know. Your psychological factor is like, okay, smaller font, smaller price, better price. That's how your mind would actually think through. So this is again with respect to marketing representation. And this is a very, very interesting facts. Okay, there are a lot of interesting facts in pricing. When you read through, it's very, very interesting. So based on your consumer segment, again, based on your product and things like that, you need to tweak. Unfortunately, my company, like in Vajro, we have primarily like female consumers. So I couldn't use this aspect at least of pricing. But men tend to, you know, read prices. They really like this red prices. So red prices meaning the color font. So whenever the font color is red, men tend to get the conversion in men is much higher, conversion rate in men. So again, Amazon, I think, has their prices displayed in red. I am still surprised of the fact that I don't know their consumer persona though. But seems like maybe it's more men making a lot of purchases in Amazon. Maybe that's a factor. So this is a very, very interesting fact that when I read, I was like curious, oh, is it so? So this is one thing. There are a lot of things with respect to font size. This is to bring perspective into these factors as well, apart from pricing, right? So color, how you represent your font size, and how you're going to display your, you know, entire plan and packaging, everything makes a lot of difference. So based on your consumer persona or customer persona, make sure you read through these entire aspects. A lot of good research is there, and I'm sure a lot of things will help together, but it again depends on each and every business. It differs from business to business. So make sure you actually do the marketing packaging part extremely well. And feature packaging is another big project altogether, where, you know, moving features from one to another. You know, I showed a consumer persona where most valued feature and least valued feature. In SaaS, again, like when you have the most valued feature in your plan that you want to sell, it's going to sell a lot more. So again, packaging is a lot more different thing that's going to come through. So these are the aspects that I wanted to make sure that we actually understand the basics in these, and slowly we can move on based on each and every business. A lot more analysis is needed, survey is needed. So for example, the entire pricing project for Freshdesk took me about like 3 months just for the research part, just to find the willingness to pay, just to find the consumer persona, and then coming up with the pricing and packaging is a lot more difficult. But make sure that you tie up all together with all these new things. Make sure you have an eye to marketing as well. When you display price, when you display plans and things like that. I actually found Price Intelligently super helpful. Very, very, very good articles, especially about SaaS-based pricing. If you want to know B2B, B2C, everything, they've actually done entire research on how top people have priced, what their consumers were, how many people did they survey, and things like that. You'll find a lot of good articles there. And I did find this particular article very, very good, especially with respect to currency conversion, where it can actually triple your revenue. So, when you're in big SaaS companies where you're selling to Europe, you're selling to also like US and India, you have multiple currencies in place. Again, pricing with the right currency, with the right number of times is also super important. So there are very good articles on those, and based on your need, I'm sure you'll be able to find very good articles on SaaS, B2B, B2C. And I did this particular course in Udemy. Okay. So when I was given this task, I had no idea about any of the metrics that I mentioned before. So it was like a scratch work right from the start. So I actually did this course when I started, and it was super helpful. It gave me a perspective. From there, I was able to read a lot more. So probably take a quick course. There are multiple, it's not just the Udemy, probably you can take up in any Coursera. I'm sure you'll find good courses. Or you can also start reading with the strategies mentioned below. And another book, I think growth hacking books are super cool with pricing. And I found this particular book super helpful for my pricing as well, Growth Hacker Marketing, and it's by Ryan Holiday. So these are the resources that help me get started. Beyond this, you need to dig deep and do a lot more research to understand pricing. So thank you, guys.
Thank you so much, Anandi. That was really, really, really good. I am actually starting to comprehend all the examples that you mentioned, and I am mind mapping them to like through all the situations that I go yeah, and I'm like, wow. Okay, so I'm just gonna open the floor to questions now.
Yeah.
So I have one question, Anandi. So I, when I was doing research for this episode, right, so I came across a YouTube video.
Okay.
I just wanted to get your opinion on this. So basically, there was this guy who mentioned that, you know, if you are like in SaaS products and you are basically have a product which you want to sell to B2B or B2C.
Okay.
So like, you know, if there's a pricing scale, either you be at the least or at the highest end of the scale. So like, do you think that makes sense, or how valid is that?
Okay. So I think that's where the band comes in, right? Mm-hmm. We did show a band where, you know, your lowest price being $200 and highest price being $600. It makes sense. What he primarily, I haven't seen the video, probably you can share. From my understanding, what is important is, when I mean my band is between 200 and 600, you need to make sure that you have a pricing point near your 200 and near your 600. So yeah. You can't be like, okay, let me have $3.99, $4.99 and probably something around $4.25 or whatsoever, you know. That is not the right way to do, because you're losing your market share, because your market share lies in $200. The closer you are to market share, that is $200, you're going to get a lot more consumers. And towards the fag end, you're also going to get a lot more volume there. This side is volume. This side is more transactional volume. Where 600 clients, you're going to quickly double up your revenue and triple up your revenue. So it's very important that you have pricing in both the bands, the too expensive part and too cheap part. Before that, you need to have a pricing point. And too cheap part is very, very lower band is super important to gain market share for sure. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, it does. Thank you. So we do have some questions. Where can I learn more about pricing strategy and the underlying psychology in detail?
Okay. So I would suggest price intelligently, reading at least a couple, or I wouldn't even prefer any course. I would rather say, like, if it's SaaS, if the question is about SaaS, Price Intelligently site is super cool with a lot of good examples. They have every product detailed as to why the pricing is right or why the pricing is wrong as well. So you get to learn a lot more. So willingness to pay, again, that particular piece, I actually understood more from their research. Okay, this is how we can probably understand willingness to pay. Okay, so that's how they calculate. And it actually helped me as well. So Price Intelligently for B2B, B2C products, SaaS is super cool site. You read 2 to 3 articles in depth, understand them in depth, go to the particular product page and understand, is really helpful. From there, you can take up concepts or metrics and read more. That's a lot easier, I would say. And maybe if you're really interested, a course would be.
Great. Okay. Samrudha is asking you that, are there any points on pricing for retaining or upgrading the current customers for SaaS products?
Okay. Really nice question. So again, upsell and churn are two different things. Like, I'll probably run through a quick ideas on how all pricing can help. First is probably like churn part, right? When you have a lot of churn meaning a lot of consumers are paying and then not renewing their subscription. Like, you pay for Netflix this month and next month you stop the payment. Then you are a churned customer. Okay, you come under this bucket of churn. So if you see a lot of particular business doing a lot of churn, Netflix doesn't do though, especially with Corona. So in case your business is actually seeing a lot of churn, then one quick thing that can help you is you have monthly payments and annual payments, right? Those are two different MRRs. So, you know, what should be done is your annual should be at least 25 to 30% cheaper than monthly, so that you retain those customers, right? You want them to pay annually and stick on to you at least for the 12-month schedule or tenure, right? So again, there's a lot of in-depth in pricing and packaging. So I'm just throwing ideas so that you can read more on those. But annual is one for, you know, retention, where you at least price your annual pricing 30% to 40% cheaper than your monthly, you are going to get. So for example, Netflix as well, right? It was like $7.99 or something like, right, monthly. So suppose you see something like the same plan being like a $500 or a $4.99, you would probably be like, oh, $300 per month, the savings is going to be, you're going to go there. So for retaining customers, you know, having your annual contracts lesser is really going to help. And second, for upgrading customers, your packaging is super important, the features, right? You need to make sure that, you know, you don't put all your popular features in one plan. You know, your most valued feature from survey, from consumers, from, you know, the metrics, your product adoption metrics and those things. When you put all your valued features in one plan, obviously people are not going to upgrade, right? Your packaging actually makes a lot of difference. So they should always look forward to the next level, so that they are in the highest plan and you derive a lot more revenue. So retention, again, I would say annual contracts is a very good way to address it. And in terms of upgrades, make sure your pricing plans are in such a way that they can easily move based on your features. And it's easy in terms of dollar value as well. That would be really great. So if your band is lesser, the jump is going to be easier.
Absolutely. You know what? I think like 15 days back, so I was buying Boot subscription. Okay. So like you spoke about annual, having an annual package. So it was basically like 99 rupees per month, or it was 600 rupees for the entire year. So I was literally like, I'd rather I'm saving 600 rupees, but I am sure I won't even use Boot for the whole year.
Exactly. Yeah. So you might not even use the subscription. Actually, if you had taken monthly, you would have probably been a churned list, right? You would have probably not been there for the next month, right? Mm-hmm. So annual contracts really make sense. Consumer in that minute, they might just go for annual. They might not realize future value or whatsoever. Yeah. So it's actually good. Yeah.
Okay. There's one attendee who's asking about any books that you would recommend. I think you did talk about one book. Can you just repeat that? I'll type that answer out.
So it's Growth Hacking by Ryan Holiday. There are multiple growth hacking books. So growth hacking books actually give you a quick tip, like something like, red color, font size, marketing tips. It's more towards marketing, but those are quick tidbits that can actually, scale up your revenue. So there are multiple growth hacking books, but I found this particular one super useful. Ryan Holiday is the name of the author.
Okay. So the next question, how often should a company revisit their pricing strategy?
Okay. Very good question, because I think many of the companies do something like a 3 or 4 years, which is actually not great. So you're supposed to do it annually. Annually is the preferred tenure when you need to relook. And again, every quarter 4 or something is when you need to relook into your consumer. Your consumer persona would have changed, right? They would have, used more features. You would have released more features. So always make sure that you know what features they are adopting and what features can be moved to higher plan to actually upgrade them. Make sure that's always there. So I would say annually and quarter 1 for all B2B SaaS companies.
Okay. Great. Okay. So the next question is, how do you decide between attractive or compromised default?
Okay. Good question. So attractive is when, the difference between attractive and compromise, we are very sure. So attractive is when you actually want them to move to the highest plan, right? And the other one, compromise, is when you want to move to the median plan. So you need to go to compromise when, depends on your business and depends on how you have packaged goods. Suppose you don't have a lot of differentiation, okay? So for example, I just have 10 features. I know 5 features are working and I have them in, meaning they are valuable. I have them in plan 2. Okay. Or it can be at $50 or whatsoever. The first plan is at $10. Okay. So when customers don't see a lot of value or difference between the plans, you're not actually having a lot of features to differentiate between plans. You need to go for compromise, where you have a super expensive one towards the end that makes them, you want them to go for the median one. You don't mind that because you don't have features to actually give it in the high-raised one, right? So that is when you need to go to compromise. So it depends on which stage of a startup or your company is in. So startups would probably need to go more towards compromise. Whereas if you are a well-defined business with a lot of features already rolled out and you have good plan differentiation, you can as well go for a decoy where it is attractive.
Okay. Before we go to the next question, I'm just going to launch a poll. I hope all of our audiences can answer this quickly. In the meantime, okay, so Keshav asks this question. So how can we differentiate lifetime subscription from a monthly annual subscription?
Okay, So a lifetime subscription in terms of a monthly and annual, you want to know, like, can you explain more, like, what exactly he wants to know? Like, do you repeat the question?
Yeah, sure. So how can we differentiate lifetime subscription from a monthly / annual subscription?
Okay, so was it to do with the metric that I showed in persona? If it's so, okay, lifetime subscription is, so for example, I'm a consumer. So monthly is when I choose a monthly plan. Annual subscription is when I choose an annual plan. Okay. So here lifetime value is, suppose I am in Netflix. Okay. So assume an easy number. I'm just keeping it as 10 rupees monthly. Okay. So I'm there for 11 months, right? So my lifetime subscription value amounts to 11 into 10. So I have given 110 to the business. Right? That is the lifetime value. Till what time they don't churn or till what they, time they are there, that is the lifetime value. And the monthly and annual are totally different things. And your lifetime value generally tends to be super high when it is annual subscription, because they're there for more number of months.
Okay. Got it. So one of our attendees said, thank you, Anandi ma'am, for this amazing session. And it is followed with a question. So it's basically, how can people in operations or other lines become a product manager? Hello? Sorry, Anandi, your voice breaking.
Is it fine now?
Yes, yeah.
Is it fine? Okay. So the question.
Anandi might be having some internet issues on our side. Let's just wait a couple of minutes.
I'm audible now.
Yeah, I mean, I can hear you, but your voice is still breaking.
Okay, give me a couple of minutes. I'll just quickly check the internet connection. Yeah. Thanks.
While we wait for Anandi, I'm just going to relaunch the last poll. So it'll be great if you can submit your answers very quickly and you can continue.
Hey, are you able to hear me now?
Yes.
Hey, I'm so sorry for the flaky net. Yeah, so can we repeat the question?
Sure.
I'm so sorry.
No issue. So it's basically, how can people in operation or other lines become a product manager?
Okay, so transition into product management is pretty easy from at least my experience, because I started out as an analyst. So the basic thing is, it depends on the opportunity within your company. So grab any opportunity that comes into the way. And I'm sure product management is a stream where, you know, a little bit of empathy and common sense would get you there. And a lot of reading on the go will really help you. So in general, it depends on companies that you're working in. So if it's a very, very, something like an Amazon, or you're already working on operations in Uber or something there, it's going to be very, very difficult to transition there. So I would suggest moving on to a startup, which is a product company, and try out a role that is suitable. Maybe start as an analyst or something that suits your need, and slowly transition into product management. So startup maybe is a way ahead.
Great. Okay. So the next question is from Srikant, and he is basically asking, what are the factors to be considered to set the pricing of a product?
Okay. So this is a very broad question. So factors to be considered for pricing, again, there are multiple things that we went through. So it's an annual thing that you want to do. So understand where your business is, understand your consumers, understand your consumer persona, understand are they willing to pay more price, entire band, and do the entire pricing and packaging. I mean, we spoke of a lot of strategies with respect to decoy and things like that. Implement those together and read more about pricing, because there are a lot of undiscovered facts as well, which can help your business.
Okay. The next question is, what are some strategies to tackle churn and reduce it using pricing strategy?
Okay. Again, I think annual subscription is a super cool way that can really help your subscription to, you know, have at least 30% or 40% lower annual fee. That is going to help your churn number to be much lesser. But in general, making sure that you just have one decoy plan. I think we spoke about decoy plan a lot. So in like five plans, if I have like two decoy plans, obviously I'm not going to sell a lot. I'm going to have a lot more churn, because consumers might go for the decoy plan, and there is always a risk. You have a decoy plan where you have less features, so obviously they're not going to utilize it much. So make sure that, you know, when you have decoy plan, you just have one and go for annual subscription if you're having a lot of churn.
Okay. So the next question is, how do you price a perpetual license?
Okay. So I am actually not aware of the licensing part. So probably I'll take a read and I'll get back to you, Ranjit.
Yes. Okay. Okay. So when you have zero customers, how to set a price for a product? So basically, I think like when you're just starting off.
Starting. Yeah. So when you're just starting, if you have a competitor, you can quickly look through. I think starting any startup, you start with competitor-based pricing. So if they are priced at like 10 rupees or a $10, go for a $8 so that, you know, you are perceived cheaper and you get consumers and you get their inputs on how the product is. So you need people to give you inputs. So start with the competitor-based pricing when you start. So that's, then you can slowly move into value-based pricing.
Okay, so this is a question from Divi. So he said it was a great presentation and thank you for this. And the first question, the question that he has for you is how to prepare and provide the best and healthy pricing option for a customer. For example, Amazon Prime being offered for $129 per month and yearly $999. Mm-hmm. So that's the question. So basically, how do you prepare and provide the best and healthy pricing option?
Okay. So healthy option for the business or for customer is going to be, I'm not sure of the question, because a healthy option for business might not be necessarily an healthy option for consumer or customer. And in general, it depends on, see, Amazon is a very, very good example of pricing. Jio is a very, very good example of pricing. They were able to price their products less because they had their bandwidth. They were able to absorb a lot of losses, but their main aim was to get the market share. So having a lesser pricing, like a 999, Amazon Prime did really well, you know, when they started off as well, and Jio as well, are classy examples of gaining market share by lowering your prices compared to competitors, super less compared to competitor. They are not like, your competitor is $10, they give actually at $2 probably. Yeah. So the difference is so high that they are able to quickly capture the market share. And once they capture, they'll slowly move into value-based pricing. You will not see a lot of freebies. So that's how it goes.
Okay. So Balaji Rao's question is, any framework to figure out pricing brands from scratch for a SaaS product?
Okay, any framework as such? Okay, so Price Intelligently has very good frameworks if you want to look through. And again, frameworks differ from B2B, B2C. There are minor modifications for certain metrics that you look forward to. But more or less, willingness to pay is one such metric which should be in your framework that will help you get through a lot of these. So there is no structured framework, unfortunately, and you need to build it from scratch for your product based on your product's, you know, lifetime. Whether it's a startup, whether, so for Freshdesk, it's different, right? I don't need to actually go for competitor-based pricing because we'd already done that probably 9 years before, right? So the framework differs. So if it's value-based pricing, the framework is a lot different compared to competitor-based pricing, right? So it depends on where your business or SaaS B2B or B2C is. And based on that, there are multiple frameworks and there's no set framework as such. But in general, I think the four steps that I underwent, right, like in terms of persona, first understanding whether it's value or mostly it's not cost-based, whether it's value or competitor, and then go for persona, then go for willingness to pay, understand your band, and then go for the packaging models with, you know, decoy pricing and other strategy. I think that's a good framework, at least broadly, to follow.
Okay. So the next question is, what would you love to build next as a product manager? So what's after Vajro in your career journey?
Okay, so Vajro is super interesting product where, you know, last year I joined, it's just been a year, so I'm not looking for transition for sure. So we are actually building a second product, okay, called Live Video. So Vajro is basically a mobile app company. We do apps for, you know, boutiques, groceries, like Swiggy kind of apps for the small guys who can't afford developers. So our pricing as such, if you see, starts from $99. So primarily, again, US, but we do have a lot of Indian consumers as well, slowly going into pricing and in terms of Vajro. So we are building a second product called Blink, which is live video. I think we are streaming on Facebook right now, right?
Yeah.
So boutiques do a lot of selling online in Facebook and things like that. So we are developing a new product there. So very good opportunity to build a product from scratch and to, you know, price it, market it, entirely doing it end to end. So right now, I'm not looking for any transition because there are a lot of opportunities in Vajro as such. So I'm really happy here.
Awesome. Okay. So Ranjit's question is basically, how do you work with discounts and offers?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is a very good question. So whenever you price, I think probably a factor that you need to consider is when you price any particular popular, especially, you know, this is going to sell, a particular plan or package is going to sell, right? That package, you need to make sure that you have enough margin, right, to discount. So, you know, $199 is going to get you there, but consumers are always going to ask for discounts. So make sure you price it a little higher. Make sure you add that factor so that you have discounting options as well. And you can also think of discounts in terms of features, right? You can give a higher planned feature in SaaS, especially. You can say, okay, you are in growth or whatever X plan or Y plan in $199. But you can actually use the feature, one or two features of $399 at $249 or something like that. So discounting actually works with, you know, not just the price, but also features in SaaS.
All right. Okay. So I think that brings us to the end of this episode. Thank you so much, Anandi, for taking out the time and doing this for us. And thank you everybody who attended this. I am sure each and everyone who attended this call are mind blown right now. Like I am, I must say. And yeah, so I mean, this was really, really full of learning for me, and I'm sure for our audiences as well, because, you know, like, be it an entrepreneur or a developer, I'm sure like we've taken a lot of information from this session. So thank you so much for doing this. And I look forward to hosting you in many more networking events at Seoul. Yeah. Thank you, Anandi.
Thank you. Thank you for hosting me. Thank you guys for joining on a Friday evening. And have a great weekend. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me via LinkedIn or something. I can always answer if I missed any questions in between. So thank you, guys. Had a great session as well.
Thank you.
Good session. Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.